18 verses. We've got one for you. It's actually marked and ready to go in the spot you're going to need it. So if you need that Bible, raise your hand. Acts chapter 11, starting in verse 1. Let me read this to you. Now the apostles and brethren who were in Judea heard that the Gentiles had also received the word of God. And when Peter came up to Jerusalem, those of the circumcision contended with him, saying, "You went into uncircumcised men and you ate with them?" But Peter explained it to them in order from the beginning, saying, "I was in the city of Joppa praying, and in a trance I saw a vision, an object descending like a great sheet let down from heaven by four corners, and it came to me. And when I observed it intently and considered, I saw four-footed animals of the earth, wild beasts, creeping things, birds of the air. And I heard a voice saying to me, 'Rise, Peter, kill and eat.' But I said, 'Not so, Lord. For nothing common or unclean has at any time entered my mouth.' But the voice answered again from heaven and said, 'What God has cleansed, you must not call common.' Now this was done three times, and all were drawn up again into heaven. And at that very moment, three men stood before the house where I was, having been sent to me from Caesarea. Then the Spirit told me to go with them, doubting nothing. Moreover, these six brethren accompanied me, and we entered the man's house. And he told us how he had seen an angel standing in his house, who said to him, 'Send men to Joppa and call for Simon, whose surname is Peter, who will tell you words by which you and all your household will be saved.' And as I began to speak, the Holy Spirit fell upon them as upon us at the beginning. Then I remembered the words of the Lord, how he said, 'John indeed baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit.' If therefore God gave these the same gift as he gave us when we believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could withstand God?" When they heard these things, they became silent. And they glorified God, saying, "Then God has also granted to the Gentiles repentance to life." Oh, Father, thank you for your word. Wow. Lord, to think that this was the beginning of the gospel, getting to us, getting to me. How thrilling, Lord. Now, God, would you instruct us as we think about, wow, the first conflict in the early church and how they resolved it. Lord, would you teach us how to resolve conflict in our lives, in our church, in our families, with our friends, in our workplace, that as they brought glory to you, we might bring glory to you as well. So, Lord, speak to us now by your Spirit, through your word, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, a good title for this message would be Trouble in Paradise. Because what we have before us in our account today is the first record of there being disagreement amongst the leaders of the early church, and a very serious disagreement it was. This is an issue that could have not only divided the early church, it could have blown that church apart. I mean, I don't think as Gentiles, as non-Jews, we are ever be able to appreciate how huge of an issue this Gentile thing was for the Jews. The Jews, and in this case, the Christian Jews, were totally convinced that God would have nothing to do with the Gentile nations, and therefore neither should they. Now, if the Gentiles wanted to come under the law, become circumcised according to the traditions of their fathers, well, that was another story. But to have fellowship with those that God would not have fellowship with, that was out of the question. To eat with those that were unclean, that was a disgusting thought to them. To allow a Gentile to be converted, that would never occur in God's economy. And so you can imagine what must have happened when news got back to the church at Jerusalem that Peter, The blessed Apostle Peter was hanging out with Gentiles, eating with them, staying in their houses, and telling them about the gospel of Jesus Christ. This would have put them through the roof. They would have seen no cost for this. In their eyes, it would have been sin. And this was not just the church in Jerusalem. The Christians in Judea were just as concerned about this. So when Peter gets back, they want to have a come to Jesus meeting with Peter. And those that have gone with him too. Now, the tenor of this meeting is not left to our imagination. Did you catch that? Luke tells us they argued about this. They contended over this. They were incensed that Peter had fellowship with Gentiles, that he ate with them. And the thought that he'd given them a chance to receive Christ, well, there weren't words for how unacceptable this was. So they were going at each other. And it was getting more and more heated by the minute. And so finally Peter says, wait, okay. Let me start from the beginning. One more time. There I was praying at Joppa. Now notice that in his wisdom he doesn't mention the location of this prayer sesh. If Peter brought up Simon the Tanner at this point, they would have probably stoned him on the spot. So he wisely leaves that out. But he goes on, while I was praying, God gave me this vision, this huge sheet being lowered down by its four corners from heaven. In the sheet, all kinds of unclean animals and reptiles. And then this voice came out of heaven. Arise, Peter! Kill and eat whatever you wish. Now, being a good Jewish boy, I answered, no, Lord, for you know I've never eaten anything that is common or unclean. But the voice answered back, what I have made clean, let no man call common. And Peter says, this happened three times. Peter, rise, kill and eat. Three times, no, Lord, it's unclean. Three times, what I have made clean, let no one call unclean or common. Just about this time, the sheet disappeared for the last time, and there was a knock on the door. There were three men, Gentile men, who had come from Caesarea. And they claimed that God had spoken to a man there named Cornelius. And he was to send for me so I could tell him and his whole Gentile household about God and the salvation that comes through Jesus Christ. Now, let's stop right here for a minute. I'm sure that Peter had already had many people come to him claiming to have a message from God. This just seems to be part and parcel of being in the ministry. I have people come to me all the time, Pastor Ricky, you won't believe this. God gave me a message just for you. And whenever I hear that, I always get a little disappointed, like, what, God, did you like lose my number? I mean, I know I changed my email address, but I posted it right back up, you know? But you see, God doesn't need a messenger service to get through to me or to get through to you. God can speak to us directly. I had someone call me one time, I didn't know this person, and they asked me, Pastor, has God spoken to you today? And I said, well, about what? And they said, well, about me and my ministry. God told me he's going to deliver a message to you as to how you were to help me. And this person goes on to tell me about their ministry and how God had called them to it. And that God was supposed to have spoken to me that day about the amount of money he wanted me to give to this person. And when I told them, you know, I didn't get that message yet today. They acted surprised and said, well, you're probably not used to hearing from God in this way. So that's why God revealed it to me, so I could tell you. And it was quite a substantial amount of money. Like, wow, really? But I told them, look, let me have your number. If God speaks that to me, I'll quit back to you. Because see, folks, that's not the way it works, is it? What we have before us in our account here, I believe, is the way this works. Notice, God spoke to Cornelius on the one end, and then he spoke to Peter on the other end. So Cornelius' vision became the confirmation of what God had just shown Peter, and vice versa. You see, if you hold to this principle, you'll never be burned by people who are hearing from God for you. You'll never be confused by people you see on TV or hear on the radio who say, I believe God has spoken to me right now that one of you has $500 in your account to buy a $500 donut. How much are those donuts? Keep going. And he wants you to give that money to him through this ministry. You see, with all confidence, you can say, until God speaks that to me, he must be talking to someone else. And that's true. On the other hand, when God shows you something or when God does speak to you, it's really neat when he confirms it by showing it to someone else, isn't it? It really is. It's very powerful. And that's what happens to Peter here. So the Holy Spirit tells him, go with these men, doubting nothing. Brings us back to our account. Peter goes on to tell them that when he gets to Cornelius' house, he begins to proclaim the good news about Jesus. And he was preaching away, telling them about all that Jesus did and all that Jesus said. But before he could even finish the sermon, the Holy Spirit fell upon them, just like the Holy Spirit fell on the Jews on the day of Pentecost, and they were baptized with the Holy Spirit. Now, when that happened, Peter said he thought about the words of Jesus. When Jesus said, John baptized you with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. So here's Peter's conclusion. He said, since God had given them the same gift of the Holy Spirit that he had given to us, the Jews, how could I argue with that? I allowed them to be baptized. By the way, we're going to have a baptism today down in Apele Bay at 11:30, right after church. He said, oh, Pastor, I'd love to be baptized. I didn't bring my trunks. You don't need trunks. No, no, it's not what you're thinking. No, we... with all your clothes on, we'll baptize you right down there. It's fantastic. We'd love to have you do this. It's going to be a great time. And church, meet us down there. It's fantastic to see people saying, I'm going to follow Jesus, right? I'm going to follow. 11:30 in Apele Beach. Don't miss that. So Peter says, if these guys have believed, they've been filled with the Holy Spirit, how can we deny water to them? And so they were baptized. Now, did Peter do the right thing? Was Peter hearing from God here? Oh, you bet he was. And notice, the Jewish Christians agreed. Look down at verse 18 in your Bibles. And when they heard these things, they became silent. Don't you like that? Just wow. And they glorified God, saying, then God also has granted to the Gentiles repentance to life. The whole thing comes together in their minds. This is a God thing. God has ordained that the same salvation that went out to us should go out to the Gentiles also, just as they are. We support this and we encourage this. Now, the ramifications of this are radical. As you can see in the latter part of our chapter here, chapter 11, when the gospel goes out to the Gentiles in Antioch, which was the Las Vegas of the Middle East, by the way. Now, you can see from this that this was a critical time in the life of the church. As this conflict hit the church, it really was standing at a very important crossroad. It could have gone down one road that would have torn the church apart, ultimately wiped the church out, or it could have gone down another road that allowed the floodgates to open for the gospel to go out to the Gentile world. Fortunately, they chose to go down the road that allowed God to reach out to the Gentile world, and that gospel got from Cornelius' house all the way to us. Isn't that great? And so the question becomes, what allowed them to make the right decision here? when so many other churches and so many other church leaderships have made the wrong decision? What did they know about resolving conflicts that we don't know? What allowed them to resolve this conflict and continue on in the right direction? Because let's face it, we don't seem to be so good at resolving conflict in the church. Have you noticed that? Someone says, yeah, come on, here we are, right here, yeah. I've been involved for 32 years in the ministry. I've seen congregations split. I've seen pastors fired. I've seen elder boards fired. I've seen a couple churches that just closed their doors altogether. There's one church that I know that has had so many different splits and times that people left, they now refer to them as waves. Wave one and wave two. And I don't know what wave they're on now. I hope it's the last wave. I do. So it's obvious we need some help here. So let's see what we can learn from this account about how to resolve conflict. Now, this is in the church, but guess what? It carries over. It's in all of our conflicts. To set the stage for this, notice first the close proximity between the conflict in verses 1 through 18 and the way that the church is used to further the kingdom in verses 19 through the end of the chapter. Just gaze down in your Bible. Look at that. Look at what happens there. There's a mighty move of God amongst the Gentiles. And the church in Jerusalem is right in the middle of it. You see, when Satan brings conflict into the church, its main goal is to get our eyes off of what we could be doing for the kingdom. There's an old adage that says, the devil will never rock the cradle of a sleeping church. Oh, but a church that's awake and alive and going for it, oh, he will shake it down to its very core. If Satan can keep us majoring in the minors instead of majoring in the majors, he's got us right where he wants us. The next thing I want you to notice is that the move of God at Cornelius' house was not inhibited by the prejudice or the misconceptions or the lack of vision of the disciples. See, God is never boxed in by our hang-ups. He's never confined by what we can or cannot handle. Now, there are circumstances where God does not move because of our unbelief. We know it's possible for believers to quench the work of the Holy Spirit, but ultimately, God is going to accomplish what he wants to accomplish in spite of us. And aren't you glad? Aren't you glad? Aren't you glad that what God wants to do on West Maui is not held back because of our misconceptions about what God can and can't do? Aren't you glad that God isn't boxed in by our prejudices or our lack of faith? But then think about this in terms of what God wants to do in your life, personally. Isn't it great that God's work in your life isn't limited to what you think is acceptable spiritually? Isn't it great that God's not bound up by our spiritual hang-ups? In fact, see, I think God loves blowing our minds with the way that he moves in our lives. And you know, God met Moses in his workplace in the form of a burning bush. God met Saul of Tarsus on the road to Damascus in the form of a light that was brighter than the noonday sun. The Ethiopian eunuch was just traveling through the desert reading Isaiah when God says, I want to meet with that man. And he sent Philip to him. And then when he was done, he actually zapped him right out of there. So there's no doubt God can be very creative in the way that he meets with us. You know, if we ever get to the point where we will only accept the moves of God that we can understand and that we can handle, we've slipped into dead orthodoxy. We are well on our way to spiritual boredom. And you know what? Our God is the God of surprises. He loves the surprises. Listen to Ephesians 3:20. Now to him who is able to do, what's the word? Exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us. To him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. Amen. Our God is not confined to what we ask or to what we think. He's able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we could ever ask or imagine, according to the power that works in us. That leads to the first thing I want you to see here in regards to resolving conflict in the church. The first thing that happened was that both sides were able to focus in on what God had done, as opposed to what they thought or felt about what God had done. You know, conflict in the church gets hot and heated because we personalize the conflict by making it "I said, you said" kind of a thing. Instead of being interested in what God had done, we want everyone to know what we think about what God had done, what we feel about it. And so it becomes your feeling about stuff and my feeling about stuff, and that gets snarly so fast. Notice how Peter avoids that when he says, "Look, this was not something I wanted. I didn't want to go out and reach the Gentiles. I was just praying. I was waiting for lunch. This was something God did. So let's evaluate it on that basis." And the saints in Jerusalem were willing to do that. See, that made the conflict objective and not subjective. Both sides were standing together looking at the same thing. That's what God wants. The second thing they did was to evaluate what they observed by the word of God. Here's what we observed that God did. Now, how does this stack up according to what God has revealed about himself through the scriptures? And again, notice, it's Peter that says, "This reminded me of what Jesus said. John will baptize with water, but you will be baptized with the Spirit not many days from now." You see, the experienced matched up with the word of God. The two were tied in together. Now, Peter could have also gone back to what he spoke through the Spirit on the day of Pentecost, when he said, "This promise of the Holy Spirit is for those who are listening and to their children and to all who are afar off, to as many as the Lord shall call." See, this was an actual fulfillment of the words that the Spirit had spoken through Peter that day. And see, they could easily see that the experience matched up with the word of God. It was consistent with what they already knew about God. You know, people, so many conflicts would just melt away if we're willing to judge an issue on the basis of the word of God. If we could just agree that the ultimate authority is God's word, then every conflict we faced would have a speedy resolution. So often the things that never should become problems blow up and become huge problems because we want to be the authority on everything. We want the final say. We want people to get on board with us. And if they don't, you better put on the gloves because the conflict is going to come. See, it boils down to my ideas about spirituality versus your ideas about spirituality. And if that happens, it gets ugly. What should be important to us is not whether people are interested in getting on our page, but whether we're all interested in getting on God's page. What we should always be striving for is all of us coming under the authority of the Word of God. Not our ideas about the Word of God, but under the authority of the Word. See, the question should never be, "Do you understand what I'm saying about the Bible?" No, but do we all understand what God is saying through the Bible? See, when that's our heart, I'm telling you, conflict is going to be resolved. What's frustrating is when brothers and sisters in Christ are not willing to let the Bible become the ultimate authority in their lives. Oh, we talk about it, we sing about it, but when it comes down to conflicts, we don't want to do it. When we're not willing to submit to the heart and mind of God as revealed in His Word. You know, I've dealt with many situations with pastors and leaders from churches and organizations where resolution never comes because they won't open the Bible and let the Bible speak to their conflict. Now, I've learned if the goal is not to see God's heart and then line up with that, man, we're just wasting our time. We're spinning our wheels. The conflict is never going to be resolved. I've also had other times with pastors and leaders in our community where there was great conflict, and it was snarly. But because of a willingness of all the parties to submit to the Word of God, there's been tremendous resolution and healing and restoration of fellowship. And those are wonderful times. So the saints here, they observed the work of God. Then they held it up to the ultimate authority, to the Word of God. And they saw they matched. They saw they lined up. Brings us to the last thing that brought resolution to the situation. And then that is that after they resolved the conflict and clearly saw what God was doing, they jumped in and they got in step with the Spirit. They saw that God was doing a new thing, and they wanted to be a part of this new thing with the Gentiles. And this is where pride can really come in and mess up the work that the Holy Spirit has done, especially if we happen to be on the side that didn't see it in the first place. Once we're corrected and we see, okay, this is a move of God and we know God is doing some great stuff here, we can either jump in and get involved, or we stand on the sidelines and we criticize it. I don't know how many times I've seen people or churches come around, they recognize that something is a move of God, only then to continue to mess things up, becoming the ultimate authority on how this move of God needs to be managed. And I'm speaking from experience here because, folks, I have done this myself. I have. There's been stuff happening, and I doubted if it was a move of God. And when I discovered that it was, I couldn't humble myself enough to just get on board. No, I had to stay back, and I had to somehow become super spiritual and try to manage this move of God. But see, that's not what God wants. No, he wants us to recognize who God is using and then jump in and co-labor with them, supplying all the resources that we can. You know, as we move through the rest of this chapter, we're going to find out that's exactly what the church in Jerusalem does. They look down in Antioch. There's this tremendous move of God amongst these Gentiles down there. And what do? Hey, let's send Barnabas, the son of encouragement, down there to help these guys out. And they do. It's a wonderful thing. So what ultimately happens is not only is the conflict resolved, but the resolution provides momentum for the work of God to go forward. And what a great thing that is. So the conflict was resolved, and the work of God continued, and that work got all the way to us. So here they are again, and listen carefully here, because listen, we're all going to deal with conflict, every one of us, whether it be in the church, whether it be in our marriages, whether it be in our families, with our brothers and sisters. Am I right? We're going to deal with conflict. So here they are. First, they focused in and observed what God was doing in the midst of the conflict. Listen, folks, God's always moving. He can move in conflict. He can move anywhere. What's God doing? What is God doing in the midst of it? Not what you feel about it, not what you think about it, but just the facts. What is God doing in the midst of the conflict? Then, take those observations and hold them up to the Word of God so we can see if the experience match up with the Word of God. Does the experience that we're seeing here line up with what God has revealed about himself in the Word of God? We want them to tie together. They have to tie together. Okay? Then thirdly, after you see that God is doing something good and it matches up with the Word of God, then get in there. Support it totally. They jumped in. They got involved with the work that God was doing. And that provided a momentum to keep the work of God going. So this story has a happy ending. And that's what God wants in every conflict. Listen, God's not worried about conflict. They don't blow him out of the water. They don't bum him out. No. What he wants is a good ending to the conflict, one that glorifies him. And so much of the conflict that we see in the church today, it doesn't do that. In fact, it ends up giving God a black eye. Doesn't have to be that way. tend to be that way. Conflict's going to come. You can count on it. But God has laid out for us guidelines that we can use to make sure that the conflict has a happy ending. So now, it's up to us to use these guidelines to make sure they have a happy ending. Father, thank you for the instruction of your word. And Lord, I wish I could say, you'll probably never have to use these instructions. But Lord, that's not the case. We're going to use them at work. We're going to use them in our marriages. We're going to use them with our children. We're going to use them in the church. And maybe most of all in the church. And so God, here's the chance, not just to be a hearer of your word, but to actually be a doer of it. And Lord, I know that the first point is important. But Lord, I think the second point is maybe the most important of all. Are we willing to submit ourselves to the authority of the Word of God? Or is it what we think, what we feel, what we want? Are we going to personalize it? Are we going to hand it over to you? And Father, I know this for me is... this is where the rubber meets the road. It's right here. We can preach about it. We can sing about it. We can read it. But will we submit our lives to the authority of your word when it tells us to forgive? When it tells us to esteem others as more important than ourselves? When it tells us to humble ourselves. When it tells us to die to ourselves and our dreams and our plans. Now that's when it gets tough. That's when it gets hard. But Father, I believe it's in that we see you do things that are so amazing, so great, so awesome. It will blow our minds. And the end is resolution. Amazing resolution. Restoration. Wow. Healing. And ultimately, your glory. So, Father, take these truths, work them deep in the people's hearts, and use them, Lord, for your glory. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.